Senator Kamala Harris had this line of questioning for Trump's pick to head ICE.
Well, the Klan was a, what we would call today a domestic terrorist group.
Why? Why would we call them domestic terrorist group?
Because they tried to use fear and force to change political environment.
And what was the motivation for the use of fear and force?
It was based on race and ethnicity.
Right. Are you aware of the perception of many about how the power and the discretion at ICE is being used to enforce the laws? And do you see any parallels?
I do not see any parallels between sworn
I'm talking about perception.
Officers and agents.
I'm talking about perception.
I do not see a parallel between what is constitutionally mandated as it relates to enforcing the law.
Are you aware that there's a perception?
I see no perception.
Are you aware that there's a perception?
That puts ICE in the same category as the KKK.
What say the great debaters, Niger Innes and Simone Sanders? Simone Sanders, too far?
You know, I think, so what we didn't play, Chris, was before that, the question of the KKK came up because Senator Harris was referring to comments that the president's nominee had made calling the Democratic Party neo-Klanist, which I'm not really sure what that is. And so without context, yes, I think folks would argue that equating the KKK to ICE is reckless and irresponsible. But frankly, that's not what Senator Harris did. And I think her spokesperson is on record saying that's not what she said. She was talking about the perception. And it is a fact that there are many people out there across the country, myself included, that think there is a that feel as though ICE currently operates with surgical precision in terms of picking out and hunting down folks in communities across this country based upon the color of their skin.
Well, based upon their legal status.
Based upon their legal status. But it also places the color of their skin. I mean, let's not forget Jarpaya, who literally would have officers stop folks driving because they looked.
Well, and Jarpaya got censured by the courts for exactly that and found in contempt because he refused to stop it. But let's get to you on this, Niger. Is this just a question of context?
Absolutely not. What it is a perversion of history. It is Senator Kamala Harris spitting on the graves of thousands of African Americans that were terrorized by the most powerful political domestic terrorist organization in the history of our country.
How so?
It is her showing how so?
Yeah.
Is she spitting on those graves?
Yes.
By comparing what ICE is doing in upholding the Constitution of the United States and the laws of our land and trying to pursue those who are breaking those laws versus the Klan that was actually trying to burn the Constitution, erode the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment of the Constitution written for Black Americans so that they can be considered full citizens, the Klan, as an organized arm of the Democratic Party, went to reverse that.
All right, now we've gone. Now this is a bridge too far. Let's just be
clear. Why is it a bridge too far?
Senator Harris is on record
saying. What did I say? That's untrue, Simone.
Senator Harris is on record saying that she's talking about the perception. When the nominee sitting in the hearing said you should not equate, she said I'm talking about perception. But to say that, you know, she's spitting on the graves of Black people, I just think is just very ridiculous language, frankly.
All right, so,
that's absolutely not what's happening.
So let's push past the hyperbole and get to the actual policy behind it. Do you believe that whether or not ICE should be abolished, is that a legit question for Democrats to be asking, in your opinion, Simone? Is that really something that you guys should be considering?
You know, I think for Democrats that have come out on record that said they want ICE to be abolished, people should be asking those folks about abolishing ICE. But I think an overwhelming number of Democrats have come out and said, we need to fix our broken immigration system, which needs to be a bipartisan effort. And when it comes to ICE, perhaps we need to revisit it. And currently, there are many Democrats, myself included, that believe ICE is not currently operating inside its mission. It is not fully funded. It does not have the resources and the real directives and the oversight that it needs to carry out its job properly. Let's be clear. ICE's job is not to enforce the border. That is, there's a separate entity for that.
Are you open to that suggestion, Niger, that it's not about abolishing? The last thing we need is less people keeping the border safe. But in terms of how they do their job, what their mandate is, and how it's executed, is that something you'd be open to reviewing?
I have strong libertarian instincts, and any government entity needs proper oversight, supervision, and direction. But that's not what some of the extremists in the progressive movement are doing. They are demonizing the thousands of decent ICE officers that are trying to enforce our laws, including Senator Harris with her perception comparison of the Klan to ICE. She don't run away from it, Simone. It was disgusting what
she did. I'm not running. It's on the record.
And she is spitting. I will say it again. Spitting on the memories of those who fought in the Civil War and the Civil Rights Revolution against the Klan that had terrorized black folk for over 100 years.
All disgusting. Right. So just so we don't conflate
history, to be clear, needs to apologize.
Look, Senator Harris is not apologizing for anything. I think that can be sure because she's been very clear about what her position is. But let's not
start talking about that the Civil...
Oh, did you just call me an apologist?
Yep,
well, look,
I think some folks... I think you need a history lesson, sir. But as it comes
to ICE, I definitely think
there's room to have a conversation about the lack of oversight that this government entity has, and how they're carrying out their mission. There are real questions and concerns
that many folks have about what's happening. Niger even walks that walk with you a little bit about oversight and being clear about it, making sure that there's no violation within a mandate. But, you know, you were pretty quick to say, hey, talk to those people who say they want to get rid of ICE. But I'm saying as a party, you're going to have to figure out where you are on that and who you endorse for positions of power, whether it's congressional leadership or who's going to be on the ballot in 2020. They're going to have to be straight on that position because I think you guys are looking for a nice beating on that issue if you talk about abolishing ICE.
Well, Chris, look, I think the overwhelming majority of Democrats and even potential people that might want to throw their hat in the ring for president have been clear that it's not just about ICE. This is about our immigration policy as a whole. And we do need oversight. And I think if you ask folks about what changes need to happen, sure, ICE is part of that conversation, but it's a smaller piece than the whole.
Right. Look, I think the more meat on the bones that you guys put,
the
better.
I mean,
I talked about this with Nancy Pelosi, and I got to be honest, Niger, I don't know if you heard the interview. But she got me a little bit on this. I was like, you haven't gone toe-to-toe with Trump. You let him run the immigration game. You let him run the fear and loathing. And we all saw that it was a ruse. He stopped talking about it right after the election day. The caravan all of a sudden caravanished, as we're all joking about it now. But it's not funny, the demonizing that he was doing, that certainly you weren't in high dudgeon about that the way you are now. But let's stick apples to apples. And she said, I told the candidates not then. You won't beat him on his lies. You won't beat him during the campaign. He's just going to lie. You won't be able to beat him. Now we'll take him on. So I want to see what the Democrats do there. Now let's assess where we are, by the way. Blue wave. Trump says, no, no, no. I won two. You don't make enough about my two seats that I won in the Senate. Niger, here's my point. You should have won more. This map was all about you guys. You got Democrats sitting in states they don't even belong in anymore. Tester, I know he's from Montana, but that place isn't voting the way Tester is now. But you lost. Joe Manchin, all about Trump. You lost that race. I think you should have won more. Arizona, that's Flake's seat. You should have won. You lost. Why do you deserve a pat on the back for two seats when you should have had five?
I'm not going to spin here. The reality is, even in the seats that we won, that Republicans won,
be it
Georgia, be it the battle in Florida, extremely tight, way too tight for comfort. And, you know, there's one thing to spin on air and give a particular perception. It's another thing that what's going on behind closed doors. What's going on behind closed doors, I guarantee, is that Republicans and conservatives, those who want to keep this country a constitutional republic and not become some Western European-style democratic socialist entity, are very concerned about our electorate and very concerned about our upcoming elections.
Well, look, you know, reality's perception. And I'll tell you what, Simone, the way you guys should be seeing it and what I've heard from your side, I want to hear if you agree, is... No, no, no. It's not about the fear of becoming a socialist republic. It's about not becoming an autocracy. And that people rejected Trump because they don't like the talk. They don't like the strong man talk. This is America. You know, this isn't the Philippines. And that's what it was about. What does that mean to your side in terms of how to capitalize?
I think it was also, in addition to that, Chris, I would agree and say it's also about the issues. You look at places like Nebraska, who expanded Medicaid, Nebraska, Utah, who expanded Medicaid through a ballot measure when the Republican governors in those states would not. Democrats now are now sitting in the governor's seats in Wisconsin, in Michigan, and in Pennsylvania, places that, if you remember, we didn't do too well in 2016, but are vital if we want to do well in 2020. So what I would say is Democrats should look at the midterm elections and say, look, we have a fighting chance. And, you know, to borrow something that my good friend Tad Devine said earlier today is, look, as long as Donald Trump is president, I think Democrats have a fighting chance everywhere. But we have to show up, we have to knock on doors, and we have to bring a message. And that's what happened in this midterm election. We didn't get caught up in just talking about Donald Trump. Democrats talked about health care. They talked about wages and the economy for middle-class, hardworking Americans. And they talked about putting a check on the president when it came to the United States House of Representatives.
Last word, Nigel.
One of many silver linings in this election is an exit poll showed that in Florida, where DeSantis won, showed that 18% black women voted for DeSantis, the Republican candidate, for and now governor-elect. That is a good sign. Rasmussen
Which
poll
exit
showed
poll was
36% support approval for Trump. There's gold
Which
in the hills in the minority community for Republicans in the conservative movement, but they got to go find that gold. They better go find that gold or else we're going to be in trouble in 2020.
Right, but just pick the right polls. Otherwise, you're looking for fool's gold, my brother. Thank you very much for being with me on a Friday night. Always a pleasure. Simone, thank you. Niger, equally. Thank you.